Hey everybody, welcome back to Jet City on the weekend in the shop in front of an Arenda 14 that we built in 2012 and it's in for servicing and readjustment. And we're building an engine in 2023. It's just not visible anymore. It's all in a million pieces, ready to go back together. So we're doing a video response follow-up to yesterday's video about the Boeing 737 twin engine failure and crash in Hawaii. Now that I've read the preliminary report, a few things have been cleared up, but we need to uncover some huge misunderstandings. Let me get back to that. Okay, the first thing that comes to my mind is people have been talking about the fuel starvation issue causes the engines to stall. Okay, that's a huge error that's never gonna go away, I suppose. If you've got a piston engine or a diesel engine and it stalls, what happens? Stops moving. When a turbine engine stops moving, that's not a stall. That means the engine quit. A stall is a violent and loud failure of the compressor to function properly, which causes unstable airflow, often huge flames coming out the front, flames going out the back, smoke, sometimes engine damage, and the engine does lose thrust, but it keeps spinning. It's going, it's running, and if it continues to stall while it's running, it will overheat, and then it will fail, and then it won't be running. Anyway, when the rotor in a gas turbine engine stops moving, that is not a stall. Okay, I guess it's not important to anybody except engine people. If you can use the right name, whatever. Here, we're gonna give you this traffic ticket for your great 2 weeks of work. What? I wanted a paycheck. Oh, it's the same thing. Here, just take this traffic ticket. You know what I mean. The titles of things do matter. It's not a stall when the engine stops turning. If the engine runs out of fuel and stops turning, that's not a stall. All right. Second of all, I've got the PDF here, which I'm trying to go through. And it says that the crew reported they lost an engine. Okay. They didn't say why. They didn't know why. They lost an engine. They're flying the plane. They got other things to worry about than why the engine stopped turning, but it stopped turning, and they lost an engine. And then they reported that the other engine was overheating. We'll get into that in a second. But that's not a dual-engine simultaneous failure. They didn't fail at the same time. They may have not failed for the same reasons. They might have, but they failed at different times, one right after another. Very serious event. But it's not the same thing as both engines going out at the same time. A couple of people have mentioned that if they run out of fuel, or if the fuel system is somehow not at the fuel control of the engines, but at the distribution or the pumping or the filtering, whatever, if something happens there, they'll both run out of fuel and they'll both stop. They'll lose power and they won't be engines anymore. They'll be just great big weights. Each engine has a fuel control. There is not a central control for both engines. It doesn't work that way. Each engine has its own separate fuel control. I've been informed by more knowledgeable people now that the engines on the 200 series, the JT8Ds, the early versions, I guess, they did not have FADEC, or full authority digital engine control. So they're a hydromechanical system, much like this. Well, this one goes right there. It's being rebuilt right now in the shop up the street. We'll be putting this back on and running it. But the hydromechanical fuel controls have a lot of automatic safeguards and limitations, and they're very good. They're very reliable. If dirt gets into it, there's a filter. Like I said, there's a filter on the truck, filter going into the truck, a filter from the truck into the aircraft, a filter on the boost pumps, a filter at the inlet to the fuel pumps, and then there's a filter at the inlet to the fuel control. So dirt might get through, but it's highly unlikely. Water, a little bit easier, maybe. Anyway, hang on a second. Okay, good thing about this incident, there was only two people on board the aircraft, the pilot and co-pilot. It was a freighter, a converted freighter. And so both of those guys, they didn't die. They got injured, but they were saved, and nobody was killed in this accident. So that's a really good thing. Interesting bit of history about the aircraft that I found out reading this report is it was a 737-200 that was originally built for Pacific Western Airlines in Canada. And it had, it was a combi. In other words, it was half passengers, half freight. Well, actually, the bulkhead could be moved for different distributions of passengers and freight. But it also had a nose wheel, like a little, looks like a ski for landing on snow in Antarctica, like you'll see in those documentaries. But it wasn't a ski, it was a gravel guard. So this 737, for me, it's kind of cool because there was only a few of those made. And what they were for was for flying into the Northwest Territories airports, and I think Whitehorse might be paved, but it would land on gravel runways. And so it would fly in Western and Northern Canada, right around here, up to Inuvik and various places like that. So kind of cool that it was a Canadian aircraft originally built. And I thought that was cool. Anyway, what else have we got? Interesting things. Okay, so they mentioned that the engine lost power. I think it was number one engine lost power. And then the second engine, the right side, the number two engine, it overheated. Okay, so overheated is a vague term. Could mean a lot of things. But I'm just going to put this down because it doesn't respond very well. Okay, so an overheated JT8D. What does that mean? Does that mean the oil temperature exceeded the maximum? Could be. If that happens, that's a cause for concern. But when you've lost one engine and the one engine that's working, the engine's overheating, you've got time, or it's the oil is overheating, you've got time to get back to the airport and you're going to be okay. Investigate the cause, whatever. Does it mean that? Or did they mean by overheating, did they mean that the EGT dial in the engine control, okay, it's not a modern airliner, it's got the gauges. There'll be an EGT gauge. Did it go into the red? Which normally means you've got to reduce power, but they've only got one engine, so they want it at as much power as they can get, so they're running it at the limit. And we'll get to this in a second, but if the engines were old and tired, and I don't mean in terms of age, but I mean in terms of where they were in the overhaul cycle, if they were near the end, or maybe they were past the end, maybe they really needed an overhaul and they were probably a couple months overdue, who knows? And it could be a variety of things, but what happens with as engines lose performance, they wear or they get contaminated or corroded on the compressor, it takes more fuel to turn the turbine fast enough to turn the compressor to get enough air through the engine to make the thrust. And so as the engine becomes more and more degraded with age or damage or whatever, it takes more fuel to get it to speed because it's less efficient. And so what that means is you're making the right amount of power, like it always makes, but the exhaust gas temperature goes up and up and up and up. And that's an indication that the engine needs to be either cleaned or refurbished and repaired. There could be deposits, or there could be damage or wear of the compressor blades, all of which are possible. And then also the turbine blades, as they age, they can lose their curvature, they can lose their surface area, they can lose their cross-sectional thickness, they can lose pieces, but they become less effective at converting that gas stream to power, and so the gas stream needs to be more forceful. And the way you make the gas stream more forceful is to feed more fuel into it, and it becomes a vicious circle that eventually the engine just can't produce the power that it needs to anymore. So it could have been that they meant. When they said overheating, it just says the crew said it was overheating. Could be a lot of things. Very interesting. And then the last point, hang on here. All right, so let's keep in mind that the Pratt & Whitney JT8D is one of, if not the most produced large gas turbine engines in all of history, with, they say here, 14,000. I've read in other sources that 18,000 of them were made. It's one of the most reliable, dependable engines ever built, definitely keeping up Pratt & Whitney's reputation as a builder of dependable engines. I got a sticker somewhere here, Pratt & Whitney dependable engines. Yeah, right there. Okay, so it's an excellent engine. An excellent engine. It's nowhere near as fuel efficient as the modern engines, but it's at least, if not more, reliable. Yeah, I'm saying that. You can't compare a 45-year-old JT8D to a brand new whatever, but when it was new and this is new, the JT8D is solid as a rock. So anyway, keeping that in mind, near the end of this article, the FAA revoked the airline's air operator certificate. Among cited violations were 33 flights undertaken with engines that were not airworthy. Okay, whatever that means, not airworthy, but they're not ready to fly an airliner for whatever reason, in the opinion of the FAA inspector, and that could be a million things. It also says here that among the cited violations were 33 flights undertaken. Not necessarily this one, but if the airline has a total of 5 planes and they've flown 33 times in recent memory with engines that were not qualified to be in the air, it's just an indication of the general state of maintenance of the engines. And so they were probably tired. They were probably tired. Who can say? I can't say what they were doing with the engines, but if you send a JT8D away to, probably now it's Kelowna Flight Craft, would have been Pratt & Whitney back in the day. I think Kelowna Flight Craft in BC does all of the JT8Ds in service now. But anyway, an overhaul is an overhaul. The engine is made to be new again. But it needs to be overhauled every, let's say, I don't know how many thousand hours, let's say 8. I don't know, it could be 4. But if the engine is near the end of that service interval, it's getting tired. And things will happen like as I just described, that for a given power level, the EGT level will be higher than when it's in brand new condition. But it's interesting, it'll be interesting to find out what actually happened with the second engine. What did go on? When you say it overheated, could mean a lot of things. My car's running rough. Okay, let's take a look at it. Let's find out why it's running rough. You know what I mean? Okay, from the shop in the afternoon, in the wintertime, on a Saturday. Thanks for watching.